Don't push my sympathy too far, Mr. Stewart. I call the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 3303 in the name of Alistair Allen on welcoming global citizenship, Scotland's international development strategy. Can I ask members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak button now? And I call Alistair Allen, Minister, to speak and move the motion. 13 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In moving this motion, it's a great pleasure to lead this debate and to introduce members to Global Citizenship, Scotland's International Development Strategy. This is, I believe, a dynamic new strategy that brings greater focus and direction to our international development work, and it recognises recent developments in international theory and practice, such as the new UN Global Goals. I'll set out the contents of our new strategy, published on the 21st of December, and also how Scotland might continue to make a global impact through international development. But before I do any of that, can I reflect briefly on our international development work to date? As many members may remember, the Scottish Government began working in this area in 2005 with a modest budget of £3 million per annum, but Scotland's own tradition of humanitarian work overseas goes back, of course, further than that into our history, with principles of global solidarity lying behind much of the work of Scots around the world. For over two centuries, Scotland has forged a distinctive tradition of seeking to tackle poverty by working in partnership with local people to improve the lives of those who don't have the access to the basic resources that we take for granted. As the inheritors and trustees of that tradition, we have, I think, developed our own distinctive approach to international development work, built on partnership and mutual respect. And perhaps nowhere is that tradition better exemplified than in Scotland's special relationship with Malawi, where our development work first began with a fund of £3 million in 2005. But of course, Scots and Malawians have been collaborating with one another to improve health and education for over a century and a half, since Dr. Livingstone first sat down with local chiefs by the shores of Lake Malawi to discuss how they would end the regional slave trade. So the myriad of connections between our two countries that have resulted from this history have become central to our development programme. If we harness the links that Scottish health workers have to Malawian hospitals, that Scottish teachers have to old Scottish missionary schools, or that Scottish parliamentarians indeed have to the National Assembly of Malawi, then it is easier to get things done, to achieve greater value for money, and to bring about culturally sensitive development that is guided by practical needs on the ground. We believe that it's a new model for development that is unique in world terms. In the past 11 years, this model has enabled Scots to achieve, I think, a disproportionately large impact in partnership with Malawian individuals and organisations. I will, yes.
Liam MacArthur, please.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for taking an intervention and for focusing his early remarks on the relationship we have with Malawi. As the co-convener of the cross-party group, I'm well aware of the excellent work that civic society in Scotland does to provide the foundations for that relationship. There is, however, some concern that some of the core funding for some of those civic networks hasn't yet been clarified. I wonder what reassurances he can offer about the discussions he's taking forward with those groups to assure them of their future funding so they can continue to carry out that excellent work he's highlighted.
Minister.
Well, the member rightly points to the importance of networking groups within Scotland, working with civic society, with churches and others. And of course, the funding decisions that he's referring to have not yet been made, but will be made soon. The groups concerned certainly will not have to wait overly long for those decisions, but I'm very conscious of the important role that they play. We brought energy access to over 80,000 Malawians in rural areas. We've established the national educational standards that are being used to assess education for millions of school children there. Education Scotland are working closely with Scottish Government and partners, having developed a memorandum of understanding with the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology in Malawi. And we've helped to quadruple the annual number of medical graduates from Malawi's only public medical school. And of course, we've provided the Scottish charity Mary's Meals with over £1.8 million over the last decade to feed tens of thousands of school pupils across Malawi. I would like to take this opportunity, therefore, to congratulate their founder, Magnus Macfarlane Barrow, on being awarded the prestigious Livingston Medal by the Royal Scottish Geographical Society. Magnus received this honour in recognition of his contribution to feeding over 1 million children in Malawi and thousands more in other countries. I will, yes.
John Mason, please.
I mean, I agree very much with what he's just said. I wonder if he'd agree with me that we both need to do the kind of longer-term investment and enabling other countries, but also the kind of shorter-term stuff, such as the meals that he's just been referring to.
Minister?
Yeah, yes, the member is right. This is the constant challenge in international development, is to make sure that we both respond to immediate need and that we think about long-term international development, and, of course, the fact that the countries that we're working in do have ambitions, like any other people in any other country, that in the future they will be in a position to be more self-sufficient than they are. But that doesn't take away from the urgent need to help now. So I want to really conclude that my comments about Malawi by saying that although what we do in Malawi is for Malawi's sake, in many cases our partnership working has created real benefits for Scottish people too. So I'm delighted to announce the over £1 million matched funding over 5 years for the Blantyre to Blantyre Clinical Research Project. Observant people will be aware that there is a Blantyre in both Malawi and Scotland. We're linking clinicians from the University of Glasgow with those in Malawi so that we can study the increasing incidence of cardiac and inflammatory disease within the Malawian population. But the results of this collaboration will contribute to research into the Glasgow effect and studies into the health of the Scottish population. As with all of our work in Malawi, this project is being carried out under the terms of the Bilateral Cooperation Agreement, ensuring that our work dovetails the government's own wider priorities and long-term vision. Our manifesto promised to renew our agreement with the government of Malawi, and we will be taking this forward in the coming year. We will also continue to ring-fence £3 million per year for initiatives in Malawi. Of course, as I mentioned, the mobilisation of Scottish civil society is central to all this, and some of the organisations have been alluded to or mentioned, whether that is the Scotland-Malawi Partnership or others. But recent years have also seen large civil society involvement in fair trade activities, and of course in 2013, Scotland became the second country in the world to achieve fair trade nation status. Scotland's capacity to help the developing world is not limited to one country, though, and in 2008, the government added several other countries to our programme across sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, and increased the International Development Fund to £9 million, with a global footprint across 7 countries. This work has received invaluable support from the network of international development organisations in Scotland, NIDOS, who have supported the growth of that sector and enabled our sector colleagues to come together to share best practice. In Rwanda, the Scottish Government is working with Tier Fund to deliver the Ending Poverty One Village at a Time project, and this project aims to empower communities to end poverty, hunger and disease through developing self-help groups and focusing on those needs identified by people on the ground. And in Zambia, through our funding of SCIAF's Kulima programme, we're able to ensure that this project has been able to help address the impact of soil degradation by working with over 1,300 smallholder farmers to increase food production levels. The result has been an improvement in the fertility and resilience of their soil to climate change. And of course, in Pakistan, the Scottish Government has provided £670,000 from the International Development Fund to run highly regarded scholarship programmes. This funding will enable 400 women from disadvantaged backgrounds to study for master's degrees and over 3,000 children from disadvantaged backgrounds to complete 1 year of primary and secondary schooling. So the last couple of years have been a good time to reflect on the international development work and to think about how to maximise its impact. In November 2015, we celebrated therefore the 10th anniversary of the Global Goals. And the First Minister has also announced that the intended framework for domestic implementation of the goals would be the National Performance Framework. To align our work with this commitment to the global goals, we launched a nationwide consultation on our international development policy. I believe that our new strategy will achieve these ends. We have brought greater geographic focus to our work by reducing the number of countries we work in. Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia will form our new sub-Saharan African project base, and we will continue our engagement with Pakistan through our highly successful focus on scholarships for educational benefit. These are four countries with which Scotland shares extensive historic and contemporary links, and where the Scottish Government can therefore focus its efforts for maximum impact. In working to the spirit of the global goals, we will concentrate our efforts as a government on four distinct priorities. Firstly, to encourage new and historic relationships with the developing world. Secondly, to empower our partner countries and increase their capacity for development. Thirdly, to engage the people of Scotland across all levels of society in the process of achieving global sustainable development. And finally, to enhance our global citizenship by showing leadership on tackling poverty and injustice at home and abroad. If I may turn briefly to the amendments which have been tabled, can I say I'm happy to support the Labour amendment. And with regards to the Conservative amendment, I did look at it carefully because there is much in it to commend it. I'm happy to confirm, for instance, that we do work closely with the UK on many projects and to agree with points made in the amendment about promoting the rights of marginalised minorities. Indeed, the new strategy embeds human rights in all of our development work, which is why I'm happy to confirm our commitment to eliminate all discrimination and to work actively for the inclusion of women and girls, the disabled, LGBTI people and other marginalised groups. However, I would make clear to members that we support and indeed are implementing the Beyond Aid agenda. And that means that we still consider aid programmes to be a vital component of sustainable development efforts in the meantime. And that's why we have maintained our development assistance funding stream in addition to an investment stream. Perhaps unintentionally, the Conservative amendment does not make clear that there is a need for both aid and trade. And for that reason, I regret I'm not minded to support the amendment. Presiding Officer, I think it would be helpful for members if I were briefly to highlight some of the further changes to our international development.
I think Minister will have to be terribly brief.
It will be very brief indeed, but I will conclude in that case by saying that I'm delighted to present this government's new
international... Didn't mean as brief as that, but go for it.
Well, how brief is brief?
The times are all over.
Okay, in that case, I want to, as I said, to indicate some of the changes to our international development work that will support us to implement our broad policy aims. Firstly, in order to facilitate the wide range of engagement that we believe we can leverage between Scotland and the developing world, we'll create three new funding streams within our International Development Fund. Our development assistance stream will fund Scottish organisations to deliver projects in our partner countries, mostly being allocated through a competitive application process. And to conclude, Presiding Officer, I am delighted to present this government's new international development strategy to the Parliament today. Scotland is a nation proud of its reputation as a good global citizen at a time where many around the world are questioning the very basis of these principles. I hope that members will agree that this strategy gives Scotland the best chance of playing a vital and distinctive role in the challenges faced by our world, and I move this motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Alexander Stewart to speak to and move to Amendment 3203.1. Mr Stewart, 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be leading on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives on this very important issue and propose the amendment in my name. We on these benches very much welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to international development. At a UK level, the Scottish Conservatives have been staunchest defenders of meeting the United Nations target of spending 0.7% on GDP on international aid. And in government, we became the first G7 country to enshrine that commitment in law. As a developed country, Deputy Presiding Officer, we have a responsibility to play our part in providing aid to people around the world who are less well off than ourselves. We must continue to contribute to the international fight against poverty and provide assistance during humanitarian crises that take place throughout the world. To that end, Deputy Presiding Officer, in our Holyrood manifesto, we, like the Scottish Nationalist Party, pledged to raise Scotland's International Development Fund from 9 to 10 million to tackle the poverty and inequality faced by some of the world's poorest and most vulnerable people. We very much welcome the fact that this commitment is to be fulfilled. While it is, of course, the UK government that plays the biggest role in delivering the British humanitarian aid, it is commended that the International Fund's budget allocation is for the coming financial year, including a Scottish Humanitarian Fund. And that is very much to be welcomed, Deputy Presiding Officer, to allow us to better respond to the growing number of international humanitarian crises which take part across the globe, and they are unanticipated or unpredictable. For the International Development Fund to continue the approach of not providing direct funding to the governments and partner countries, that is the right thing to do. The targeting of the funds to specific projects will ensure that not only in our funding spend, it will achieve the best possible outcome for these individuals and partner countries, but will also ensure that we get the best value for the money for our taxpayers. Just as important as the development assists in developing ties between Scotland and our partner countries, however, it is trade and investment. Targeted investment, along with the critical involvement with the private sector, that makes Scotland's partner countries able to take part in this transition, and therefore sustaining economic growth for the future. That's vitally important, Deputy Prime Minister, that we can continue to develop and support them to develop and forward themselves within these countries. While the Global Citizenship publication does make reference to this, our amendment today seeks to put a greater emphasis on the long-term, more of a direct approach within supporting these countries. In Scotland, we are increasingly lucky that we have so many communities and organisations who are partnering across the world and want to forge relationships and forge progress in the developing countries. Civic society plays a vital role in the contribution to international development, and it is very welcome that the Scottish Government strategy values the efforts of these groups. They require to be given support, and they require to be looked after. As a relatively new member, Deputy Presiding Officer, I am really chuffed beyond belief that I got the chance to become a co-convener of the Malawi-Scotland cross-party group. I see that as a real privilege because I am astounded by the amount of work and the amount of organisations who participate in that and the interest from hundreds of community projects that foster links between these two countries in every part of Scotland is to be commended. Scotland is the longest standing in history with links with Malawi and dating back to the explorer and missionary David Livingstone, who arrived there in the 1850s. The close ties between the two countries have only strengthened in recent years with the signing of the cooperation agreement between Scotland and Malawi in 2005. The many community-based projects that we have seen throughout Scotland, like those that link with Malawi and the great foundations that we're building on international development strategy, are, as I say, to be commended. By using these existing relationships and encouraging people across civic Scotland, we can see the talents in our churches, in our schools, our universities, in our businesses, and our community groups. And in doing that, they are representing a wider possible support across communities throughout Scotland. We must not forget, however, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the human rights record of some of our partner countries is poor. Same-sex relationships, for example, are criminalised in Malawi and Zambia and Pakistan, and women still face significant discrimination, particularly in Malawi and Pakistan, and we have to acknowledge that as we go forward. We on these benches were somewhat disappointed that the Scottish Government's motion today failed to include any reference to doing more to protect human rights in these countries. While the Global Citizenship in Scotland's International Development Strategy talks about taking economic inequalities and fails to mention the challenges marginalised and vulnerable individuals and often face criticism and harassment. In 2 seconds, Mr. Crawford, just let me finish this paragraph. Our amendment thus calls on the Scottish Government to do more to promote the needs of these individuals and partner countries. Thank you, Mr. Crawford.
Bruce Crawford.
I recognise, obviously, you made the point that it wasn't contained specifically in the government's motion, but the minister did outline that the specific position that they took in regard to the issue you just raised. I think it would have been at least reasonable for you to recognise that.
Mr Stewart.
I was about to come on to that, Mr Crawford. I had written it down because it wasn't in my initial speech, but it is now. And we come on to that very point, Deputy Presiding Officer, that I would like to acknowledge today that the Scottish Government have taken on board some of the concerns that we have raised. And I think it is very important that you acknowledge it and we acknowledge it. And together, as I say, we can work collaboratively, because I do believe there's a lot of work that can be done across parties, across organisations within Parliament and civic society that can endeavour that. So I do acknowledge and thank you for taking that on. Moreover, I am pleased to note that the Global Citizenship publication refers to the close working relationship between Scotland's Government and the Department of International Development and also the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. These partnerships are already invaluable in the relations with Scotland and places like Malawi. And as we move forward, and we want to continue to develop in Rwanda and Zambia, all of these relationships will become much more apparent. In concluding, Presiding Officer, because time is now moving on, the points I want to bring forward today is that there is much consensus on this issue within this chamber, not just among the parties of, across this, but throughout Scotland. I am very proud of the international development efforts that Scotland's two governments are leading the way on international and providing help for those that need it. And to that end, the Scottish Government broadly welcome the Scottish Government's strategy for international development and hope that we can continue to build on our success in these areas in the years ahead, and also urge the Scottish Government to consider carefully the efforts to promote human rights in our partner countries. And as I say, I'm delighted that has been incorporated as we move forward. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, I therefore move the amendment in my name and thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. Can I remind members not to use the term you in the chamber, but either the member's name or the member. I now call on Lewis MacDonald, please, to speak to and move Amendment 3303.2. Mr. MacDonald, 7 minutes or thereabouts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And the government's motion today talks about a strong cross-party collaborative approach and support for international development in the Parliament. And there is indeed broad consensus. And Scottish Labour has been proud to be part of building that consensus. We welcome this strategy paper. What we now want is for the government to go beyond these 24 pages of good intentions and set out in detail what it will do to deliver them and how. And I know the minister will welcome the opportunity, the invitation to attend the cross-party group on international development in order to perhaps address those questions in more detail than he will have time to do today. And I'm glad also that the government has indicated that it will accept our amendment in the same spirit. Discussion of Scotland's approach to international development is always likely to start with Malawi, as it has done again today. Key early decisions in shaping a distinctive strategy for Scotland's devolved government included core funding of the Scotland-Malawi partnership and establishment of the Malawi Development Programme in 2005, as the Minister has acknowledged. Jack McConnell's vision as First Minister and the vision of that coalition government was to build on the long-standing partnerships in church and civil society between Scotland and Malawi, and for Scotland's devolved government to add value, both directly in financial support and indirectly in providing a focus for the efforts of others. And that remains just as important today. For every £1 in official government assistance, according to the Scotland-Malawi partnership, there is a further £8 in support from civil society, with over 1,000 individual partnerships or connections between individuals and organisations in the two countries. Many of those links are of long standing, but others have been stimulated by government-to-government engagement over the last 12 years. For example, individual congregations of the Church of Scotland had long had links with their counterparts in the Presbyterian Church of Central Africa, and these have grown and developed in the context of government support. The Presbytery of Aberdeen, for instance, twinned with its counterpart in the city of Blantyre in November 2005, the same a point in time as the Scotland-Malawi partnership was established, and there are now 18 individual twinning links between congregations in those two cities alone. The government's latest strategy proposes a closer focus, perhaps, on Malawi and three other countries. In principle, we think that a strong focus on a small number of countries makes sense. That way, the relatively modest Scottish Government budget can make the biggest difference where it is needed most. At the same time, we recognise that development partnerships in civil society are independent of government and all the more valuable as a result of that. Organic connections at grassroots levels can survive changes in government and changes in policy and can continue to deliver at a local level whatever may be happening elsewhere. It follows, therefore, that government must not be prescriptive when it comes to development work undertaken by civil society. A focus by government on particular countries may encourage others to follow suit, but it should not discourage or downplay other independent initiatives by local churches or faith groups, local councils or other partners which choose to support development elsewhere in the world. Alexander Stewart, in moving his amendment, made some important points. For example, that the Scottish Government should continue to work closely with the UK Department for International Development. The UK is indeed one of the biggest providers of development assistance in the world, along with the United States, Japan, Germany, France, and of course the European Union. And so working with DFID and the EU institutions will be essential to get the best outcomes from Scottish aid spending. And it is simply a fact that Scottish taxpayers contribute far more through the UK and through the EU than through the programmes of the Scottish Government itself. We can also agree about the importance of supporting minority, marginalised and vulnerable groups in the delivery of aid, and I was pleased to hear the Minister's assurances around human rights. Where Mr Stewart's amendment does cause concern, however, is the reference to encouraging the move from aid to investment in developing economic growth. Of course, aid is a means to an end. Successful development assistance does ultimately put itself out of business. But that is quite different from making a political choice to shift the whole focus from aid to investment, regardless of how far poverty or the obstacles to inclusive economic growth have been eliminated. And we've heard the International Development Secretary suggesting that her department's role should focus more on trade and economic advantage for the UK itself. So we are bound to worry about the political choices being made by some of Mr Stewart's party colleagues elsewhere. Our choice should be to work for sustainable and inclusive growth and to use both aid and investment towards that end. Labour's amendment calls for more detail of the government strategy and highlights in particular the country strategies and policy coherence across the government itself. Non-governmental organisations keen to support in-country work need to understand the mechanics of how applications to the International Development Fund and the Climate Justice Fund will actually work, when applications can be made, the number of stages which will be involved, and whether the grant receiver will be required to part fund projects. There are also questions about how the government will seek to build sustainable long-term partnerships in country and to make best use of local resources and local expertise. And just as local authorities and voluntary organisations in Scotland would want to be able to plan on the basis of three-year budgets rather than one-year funding commitments, so NGOs would like to have certainty about longer-term support for projects which will take time to mature, or indeed, as Liam MacArthur said, for core funding of their essential work that allows them to deliver individual projects. Part of that will depend on how the government intends to assess and evaluate the projects it supports and how it will use those evaluations to improve the effectiveness of future projects. And when the government commits to going beyond aid, it is important to know how it intends to do that in relation to its own activities out with the international development programmes we are debating today. Direct assistance, for example, from police and health and education services in Scotland to building up those same services in Malawi is important. But it's also useful to know, and important to know, how the government intends to embed its commitments on development, human rights and global justice in its routine decision-making process across government, just as it does in considering impacts on business, the environment and equalities. So I hope the Minister will be able to respond to many of these points in closing the debate today, and on that basis I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr MacDonald. Now move the open debate. Joan McAlpine, followed by Ross Thompson. Ms McAlpine, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Scottish Government's International Development Strategy and its £10 million funding commitment, alongside complementary funding streams such as the Climate Justice Fund and the Humanitarian Aid Fund. And I note that All of these have been welcomed by a range of stakeholders in advance of today's debate, including SCIAF and Oxfam. But I'd like to begin my comments today by taking this opportunity to promote the general principle of international aid, because it has lately been under attack from elements of the right-wing press and perhaps what is known as alt-right politicians. And it's important that we counter these attacks, and I believe that our cross-party record of support in Scotland puts us in a good position to do that. It's now almost 12 years since 225,000 people, all dressed in white, marched through Edinburgh in support of the Make Poverty History campaign in 2005, and I'm very proud to say that I was one of them. It was then the 20th anniversary of the Live Aid concerts, which had first focused the world's attention on Africa. And the point of Make Poverty History was that the spirit of Live Aid needed to be permanent, and that the problem of global poverty and inequality required not just charity, but global structural and political changes, and of course, hard cash. And 2005 was also the year in which the then Scottish International Development Strategy has its roots. The G8 summit was taking place in our country, and the focus of that summit was alleviating absolute poverty from the developing world and sub-Saharan Africa in particular. And I would want to pay tribute to the then government of Jack McConnell, who felt it was important that Scotland did its bit to make a difference, and that was not without some opposition, probably by the same right-wing papers that are attacking aid today. That year, the Scottish Government signed the agreement with Malawi, which has been so successful, and of course the incoming SNP government unveiled an international development strategy in 2008, which is being replaced today after extensive consultation and assessment. My own involvement in this area back in 2005 was also professional, in that I was editor of the magazine for delegates to the G8 summit that year, and I sent Scottish journalists from the Herald newspaper to Eritrea and Tanzania to put a human face on the issues discussed by world leaders. The then Millennium Development Goals were committed to things like access to clean water, reducing child mortality, and accessing education. And one of our reporters went out to Eritrea and rose before dawn with a little girl in East Africa to make the long 5-kilometre trek with a pitcher to collect muddy water for her family before she even managed to get to school. Of course, sometimes she was too tired to go to school, and that was the human face of Make Poverty History. Diarrhea caused by dirty water and bad sanitation is still the second biggest child killer worldwide, and there are 2.4 billion people in the world who still lack access to improved sanitation. But partly as a result of the G8 summit in Scotland and the commitment made there, real advances have been made. According to the UN, the world has met the target of halving the proportion of people without access to improved sources of water, 5 years ahead of schedule. And between 1990 and 2015, 2.6 billion people gained access to improved drinking water sources. This is just one area. We've also seen improvements in maternal health, access to education, and a reduction in the number of people living on what was then less than a dollar a day in 2005. And that is as a direct result of international aid, because international aid works. And world leaders committed at that G8 summit to spend $48 billion a year by 2010, and $1 billion a year, $1 billion a year was used wiping out debt for the most highly indebted poor countries. And all UK political parties committed to maintain the aid target of 0.7% of national income. And while I have many disagreements with the government of David Cameron, it was commendable that he stuck to that commitment. I just hope that the present government and the international development under Priti Patel maintains that commitment that existed under Mr. Cameron. I'm very pleased to note that there's absolutely no chance of us reneging on any of our commitments that we've made in Scotland. We contribute, of course, to the UK's spending through our taxes, and our own fund is an addition to that. But there's a consensus here in Scotland that's the right thing to do, and it makes us better global citizens, to borrow from the title of the new strategy. It's fair to say that there appears to be a consensus among the submissions from charities that the priorities of the strategy should address those in greatest poverty. And by focusing on just four countries, three of them in sub-Saharan Africa, we can do that more effectively. The Scottish Government's approach to date has also been tightly focused, working with NGOs and experts across Scotland and in the countries themselves, and it's fair to say that this system is more accountable than when large sums of aid are channelled through government. The Scottish system of delivering small grants and project funding allows us to see exactly where the money is spent. And I had a glance at the Scottish Government's grants for 2016, and I was very impressed at how well they illustrated the aims of the new strategies. For example, £20,000 to enable Haemophilia Scotland to educate 300 health workers in Malawi about bleeding disorders, an excellent example of partnership. Another £48,000 to help communities suffering from leprosy in Zambia and Tanzania to generate their own income through work. And many other projects over the years in Scotland have particularly helped to improve maternal health with clinicians from Scotland travelling to Malawi. However, I do agree with SCIAF in their briefing that we should always, where possible, use expertise and workers in the country itself to build up capacity there. And a good example of that is the work that the Scotland-Malawi Business Group has been doing with Stirling University, backed by the Scottish Government, to promote aquaculture on a small scale in Malawi so that people can earn a living, improve nutrition and food security in local communities through small-scale fish farming. I think this is a good example of the beyond aid approach. You give a poor man a fish and you feed him for a day, you teach him to fish and you give him an occupation which will feed him for a lifetime. That's a very, very old Chinese proverb, but I think it's particularly apt for our 21st century international development strategy today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And can I remind members of the open debate, if you all take 7 minutes, we get everybody in. Ross Thompson to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Mr. Thompson, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm sure that all members in the chamber today would agree that it is the responsibility of developed nations such as our own to contribute towards sustainable international development and to cooperate globally with our international partners towards achievement of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. I therefore welcome the Scottish Government's £10 million commitment to continue to take action to help tackle poverty in relation to some of the world's poorest and most vulnerable people in areas of Malawi, Zambia, Rwanda and Pakistan. This, on top of the UK Government's £12 billion international development budget, really demonstrates that Scotland and the UK is punching above its weight in our commitment to promote sustainable international development. By working together, we're able to tackle the global challenges of our time, including poverty and disease, mass migration, insecurity and conflict. This work is building a safer, healthier, more prosperous world for everyone. International development is not just about creating stability and tackling poverty abroad. It also contributes directly to our own security and prosperity at home. It was Andrew Mitchell, MP, who said that the security of our country is not only maintained by our brilliant armed forces, it's also secured by training the police in Afghanistan or building government structures in the Middle East. Those things that make Britain more secure and stable and are funded from international development. I applaud the Minister for International Development in Europe for his commitment in the strategy paper to aim even higher and to achieve our development goals within our partner countries and beyond. However, it is also important to recognise potential shortcomings within the strategy, not simply for the sake of doing so, but to help enhance it. Firstly, the UN Sustainable Development Goals are built on the principle of leaving no one behind and endeavouring to reach the most vulnerable first. Indeed, the Scottish Government's paper notes that its commitment to the global goals must reflect and mirror our domestic aims and ambitions for Scotland. With that in mind, the Scottish Government should contain a greater emphasis on the importance of deploying international aid to reach vulnerable and marginalised communities. And the Chamber will be aware of the concerns of Stonewall Scotland on LGBT inclusion in development, who state that there is a lack of recognition that barriers other than economic inequality, such as criminalisation, ostracism and harassment, can hold individuals back and stop them accessing vital services, including through international development programmes. Although I welcome the Minister's reassurances, I would make the following points. In Pakistan, the Scottish Government strategy places a strong emphasis on education. But what about the millions of LGBT people in Pakistan who live in fear of the death penalty for simply being who they are, unable to enjoy the personal freedoms that we do here in Scotland? And in Malawi and Zambia, the Scottish Government will form part of its sub-Saharan African project base to foster cross-border learning. What about the fact that these countries continue to criminalise same-sex relationships, imposing draconian penalties on individuals for simply being in love? I would therefore urge the Scottish Government, wherever possible, to consult with local human rights defenders in partner countries to guarantee that an inclusive approach is taken and that the projects we support actively and effectively promote freedom, personal liberty and pursue real change. We are all proud of the role Scotland plays in the world. That being said, it is also important that we follow the public pound to ensure that hard-earned money of Scottish taxpayers does not end up in the wrong hands, but will be helping the most vulnerable and oppressed who most desperately need it. We also need to learn the lessons of the past. This is especially true in the wake of allegations that over £2 million of UK aid to Gaza has been funneled to Hamas by so-called charitable organisations, enabling the recognised terrorist organisation to build tunnels and purchase weapons in preparation for a third intifada against Israel. It is an unfortunate fact that corruption... yes, absolutely.
Claudia Beamish.
I'm grateful for the member taking intervention. And while he may have his own views on this issue, I'd like to highlight that in the words and fact of my colleague and friend in front of me, Anas Sawa, over many years, Gaza City is like putting a big wall around Glasgow, and there is a prison within which people have to live. And if it wasn't for UNRWA aid and the support from a whole range of countries, it would be an even worse, unlivable situation there.
I thank the member for your intervention. The point I'm making is not the support we give, but where the support goes. It is right that we help the most vulnerable. I have made that clear in what I have said. But we have evidence of where it has got into the wrong hands and facilitated acts. Well, I don't want to get dragged into that. I'm just making a brief point about the importance of following the public pound, and I would like to move on.
It's for the member to decide whether he takes the intervention, not back benches or indeed front
because
benches.
Because the Scottish Government strategy must always ensure a process of real due diligence to guarantee that our taxpayers' money reaches the projects which help with peace, not hatred, discrimination or violence. Finally, our amendment encourages the Scottish Government to support investment and economic growth in our partner countries. Now, I think contrary to the view that the Minister expressed when he was opening, not only can international development aid encourage and promote democracy, but also the development of international trade. It's not one or the other, it's both. Securing trade agreements with developing nations can help reduce poverty by stimulating economic growth, encouraging investment, and creating jobs. We can benefit in Scotland by enhancing innovation, improving skills and strengthening the ties between nations to secure peace and stability, particularly in the most troubled parts of the world. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe that our amendment is considered and I think it draws fair attention to the issues of real importance where we feel they've maybe not been fully considered by the Scottish Government's strategy and their own motion. I would therefore urge the Minister to reconsider. I believe that there is common ground between us and we could all build a consensus today. If not, I would therefore urge all members to support the amendment in the name of Alexander Stewart. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Claudia Beamish. Mr. Stevenson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a debate that is founded upon principle in the paper that we're speaking to today on page 17, we capture some of the principle. Our approach to international development is one of working in partnerships of equals with others, both within Scotland, in our partner countries. And I think that goes to a very important point. This is not about what we do to people, it is what we do with people. Because if the people with whom we are working are not with us, then we're going to achieve nothing of long-term benefit. Looking at the underpinnings of the whole issue, Ban Ki-moon and Ross Thompson referred to the United Nations said, saving our planet, lifting people out of poverty, advancing economic growth, these are one and the same fight. And at the moment, of course, our eyes will be looking at what may happen in the United States. Currently, one of the biggest contributors in this particular area, and one where we perhaps may doubt the future commitment. So looking to John F. Kennedy's inaugural address in 1961, to those people in the huts and villages of half the globe struggling to break the bonds of mass misery, we pledge our best efforts to help them to help themselves. I wonder if we'll hear that in the next few days in the United States. Perhaps Theodore Roosevelt, in his speech in Washington in 1906, got to the heart of where the United States now seems to have got. He said, "The liar is no whit better than the thief. An epidemic of indiscriminate assault upon character does not good, but does very great harm." Let's hope that the events of the election in the United States can be put behind us and that the Republicans can return to their founder, Abraham Lincoln, who at Gettysburg said, "All men are created equal." He meant, of course, women as well, at the times have changed. The faiths that underpin the moral codes of communities across the world also speak to this. And Isaiah chapter 58:6 says, "To undo the heavy burdens and let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke." So it is all pervasive in the thinking of the human race. And like others, I quote from Jack McConnell. I give Jack McConnell great regard for two things that he did in his time in office. First of all, on smoking, but this is the other one, where he said on the 1st of June 2005, "If we are not part of the solution in Africa, we exacerbate the problem." And Jack McConnell was absolutely correct in that regard. It's worth saying that the last year has been a tough one for international relationship. We've seen intolerance become almost normalized in too many parts of the world, and perhaps the hope that we might look to a better future for all the peoples of the world has all but vanished. In The Once and Future King, written by T.H. White, he ends his story of hope at the point of his own death. But before he passes, he imparts a vision to a young boy. The last line of that book reads, "The beginning." So let us hope that what has happened in the last year in particular, in the face of defeat, that we are actually now looking at a new beginning. And in doing that, we can work with our partners, sharing a vision. In a world that's riven by intolerance and disregard, it is much more important than ever that we address building bridges with those who we can work with to improve their conditions and to give our young people very often the opportunity to learn from those who are less well off than themselves that there are different ways of addressing the world's problem. Ban Ki-moon has been quoted by myself already and I think is an excellent place to start. And of course, the vision must simply reflect that. We must tackle each part of the issue with our partners. Climate change is one I've spoken about before, and in particular, climate justice. Mary Robinson, the former President of Ireland, now runs a foundation that addresses that issue and works very largely with women, many of them in Africa. We've heard of children going out to collect muddy water for their family before going to school. We know that women have to travel further and further as climate change aridifies the area in which they lived to get wood for their fires. We here, of course, in benefiting from an industrial past, are part of the reason that these burdens are being placed on people in less developed countries. That is why it's important that we stick to the knitting on climate change, while also working with the individuals most affected by it, whose problems we have very largely in that respect created. Working to end global poverty reinforces our own commitment to defeating it here in our own country, shows that our actions are not simply limited, we're not selective, no human being anywhere should suffer the pain of poverty. The diversity of peoples, the diversity of approaches strengthen the outcomes that we're likely to get. Diversity is intrinsically of value. I've before quoted the first law of epigenetics, that the more highly optimized an organism is for one environment, the more adversely affected it is by change in that environment. And that gives us the scientific underpinnings as to why diversity means you have more resilient societies, more resilient ecosystems. International development is an opportunity. It's an opportunity to create a certain unity of purpose across national boundaries. The greatest problems of our time will not be defeated by the actions of a single nation, but by the collaboration of all nations. Partnerships give us that collective power. This paper the Scottish Government has brought forward is a very encouraging part of developing a global response, but we are but a small part. But let's hope that we are an exemplar that encourages others to greater efforts in future.
Thank you very much. I call Claude Beamish to be followed by Kate Forbes. Ms. Beamish, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to add my voice to welcoming the Scottish Government's new development strategy today. Internationalism is indeed a proud facet of socialism, and Scottish Labour is supportive of the new Scottish Government strategy and the role that we can play here in Scotland in influencing progressive futures on the global stage. I too would like to highlight the contribution of Ban Ki-moon and would like to start by paying tribute to him as General Secretary of the United Nations and as his term has recently ended. And I quote, he said, "This generation is the first in humanity's history with the capacity to end endemic poverty and the last with the chance to halt catastrophic climate change." The UN global goals for sustainable development are a powerful and important guiding force for the path we all hope our global community will take. The goals are set targets to end extreme poverty, inequality, and climate change by 2030, and their might has been bolstered by the engagement of not only 193 world leaders, but also through social media and reaching out to young people across the world. Raising awareness of these kinds of ways to fuel a sense of shared duty and encourage the behaviour changes which we must make. It is absolutely right that the Climate Challenge Fund is featured in the strategy. Climate change is perhaps the greatest challenge we face and is demonstrated by the references in so many of the UN goals. Creating partnerships in the four targeted countries mean we can share the valuable expertise garnered at home, as highlighted by Stuart Stevenson. The Scottish Government motion, and I quote, recognises the holistic approach necessary to achieve sustainable development through a shared duty to consider everyday decisions and behaviours in Scotland and the impact that these have on developing countries. A fine example of this is the charity, the Tier Fund Scotland. Through the Climate Justice Fund, they have been able to assist with water resource management in Malawi, making clean and safe water more available, setting up district and community systems for governing resources, and empowering targeted communities with strategies to adapt to climate change. The benefits of community empowerment initiatives like these are far-reaching, from the reduced risk of waterborne disease to making bricks and mortar for new infrastructure to saving valuable time for those who would collect water, often women and children. And the charity states, I quote, "More people have escaped from poverty in the last 25 years around the world than at any time in history. But at Tier Fund Scotland, we are concerned that climate change and rising inequality will reverse that unless we act now." The charity also asks us to act here in Scotland on a number of issues in the climate change plan. And it is right that we have a robust link with what we do here and what we do globally. Last year, the COP23 saw the launch of the Marrakesh Vision, a pledge by 48 nations to dramatically cut emissions. And as I highlighted in a parliamentary motion in December, the most inspiring part of this vision is a commitment from some of the poorest nations around the world, nations that have contributed least to climate change. And Scotland is resplendent with the opportunity for renewable energy creation. And the Marrakesh Vision should remind the Chamber that we must not squander that privilege and must strive for greater progress in decarbonisation. I want to also speak about the support the Scottish Government's targeted approach, as highlighted by our amendment spoken to by Lewis MacDonald, shows how important it is that that we look for detailed plans and the way forward. The Minister highlighted the myriad of connections with Malawi. As a member of the cross-party group in the last session, I was further able to witness the strength of the links between Scotland and Malawi, and the Scot-Malawi partnership makes a significant contribution to these. The empowerment and support of women is an area of great importance globally, of course, and I was able to contribute in a small way to a day of sharing knowledge and experience with women from both countries about the opportunities for women in civic and political life, the barriers we face, and the positive action necessary. Can I ask the Minister, in summing up, what contribution the Scottish Government intends to make to supporting women in our four sister countries in the global quest for gender equality? And specifically, whether there will be any work to develop the scourge of, to tackle the scourge of men's violence against women and children in these four countries. The Scotland-Malawi partnership also works to develop relationships between schools here and in Malawi. In my own region in South Scotland, there are a number of schools, including Beeslack Community High School, Newton Grange Primary School, Pennycook High School, Carstairs Primary School, Liberton Primary School. The list continues. And I quote from the partnership saying, all have active, dignified, two-way school-to-school links, which are informing and inspiring generations of young Scots to be good global citizens. As an ex-Eco Schools coordinator, I would like to recognise the global citizenship as part of the Green Flag programme. Indeed, the Climate Coalition is running Show the Love project with a free resource pack this February to highlight climate change. And Oxfam, excuse me, not the only one suffering from a virus, I think. And Oxfam has produced Food for Thought for primary learners to look at Malawi and use a version of Snakes and Ladders to learn about the experiences of small-scale farmers. Can I ask the Scottish Government how links with our four sister countries will be encouraged specifically through the Eco Schools programme? And as a member of the cooperative group of MSPs, I also ask the Minister if he agrees with me that the opportunities for people and communities to take financial, productive and negotiating power into their own hands here in Scotland across the world through cooperative models are clear to see, and whether the strategy will highlight these ways forward. Finally, I make a plea that the Scottish Government will seize every opportunity to contribute to conflict resolution through the new strategy, not least through whatever involvement possible to support the development of non-proliferation treaties to rid our world once and for all of nuclear weapons. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Kate Forbes, who followed by Alison Harris. Ms. Forbes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For 2 years, I used to pass a tarpaulin-covered shack on my way to school each morning. Not a heap of rubbish, although you might be forgiven for thinking it was, but a semi-permanent home for a family with 4 or 5 children. Through every season, only a thin sheet protected them from the scorching sun or the heavy rain. The father and mother and the eldest children, who were probably my age, were probably manual labourers when they could find work, building roads and houses with loads of bricks and cement perched precariously on their heads and their worn sandals barely protecting their feet from the gravel. The toddlers would play in the dust by the road, stopping to smile as my siblings and I walked past in our smart uniforms, our packed lunches and textbooks in our school bags. And that, for me, is injustice. I met and saw countless families like this, but I wanted to pick just one today to really personalise this debate. One family out of 836 million people living in extreme poverty worldwide. One household who face more than just lack of income and resources, but who have limited access to education and healthcare and face discrimination and exclusion from society. And the UN's number one global sustainable development goal is for them, wherever they are now. It's to end poverty in all its forms, everywhere. The Scottish Government's new international development strategy is a message to the world that we will play our roles with Malawi, Zambia, Rwanda and Pakistan to achieve mutual progress towards the UN global goals. And if the benefits of ending poverty and meeting the UN global goals are mutual, then the means by which we have to do it must be collaborative. And this is at the heart of the Scottish Government's strategy. We might be a fairly small nation, but we certainly stand on the shoulders of giants whose belief in the ethos of the common weal, sharing wealth, whether that be financial, faith and friendship, for the common good, wasn't restricted to their own front gardens, but beyond. And it wasn't born of an inflated view of self-importance, but a view of common humanity. Men like David Livingstone, a medical missionary from a humble home in Blantyre, whose working life began at the age of 10 in a cotton mill, and whose explorations of the African continent and crusades against slavery made him a national hero. Or Mary Slessor from the slums of Dundee, who started working at a mill aged 11 and then travelled to West Africa as a missionary who fought for women's and children's rights. Presiding Officer, I passionately believe in community, and none more so than the global community. There is an enormous challenge before us and a moral obligation to act, but not as the paternalistic benefactors of generations past, though I fear there is still a strain of imperialism in a lot of our public rhetoric from politicians, the press, and others. The Scottish Government's approach to international development, as has already been quoted by Stuart Stevenson, is working in, and I quote, a partnership of equals with others. The purpose is to empower communities within and beyond our borders, and only a partnership approach with a mutually beneficial goal will empower the communities to effect change and work towards sustainable development. This approach dignifies all partners. My own personal desire to empower communities is what drives my service to my constituents, and I'm so pleased that the Scottish Government strategy puts empowerment rather than charity alone at the very core of our internationalism. I've already mentioned Mr. Livingstone, and many others in this chamber have mentioned our long-standing relationship with Malawi, which is a great example of a mutually beneficial and valued enterprise. And I'd like to thank the Scotland-Malawi Partnership for all that they do, as the very title of that organisation is evocative of a relationship of friends and equals rather than reliance and subsidy. The strategy under debate today also considers the importance of funding opportunities for Scottish organisations which support young people to volunteer, to realise their own role and to be a force for good in the wider world via education and the example we set. Earlier this year, I saw the enormous potential of young people pursuing the common global good as a mentor at the Commonwealth Youth Parliament. With young people from 66 regions, there was great variety in culture, language, and experience, and yet much friendship and unity of purpose. If they are the future leaders, then there is great hope that international friendships of the future will develop great global partnerships. In September 2015, 193 world leaders agreed to 17 global goals for sustainable development, to end extreme poverty, inequality, and climate change. It can be easy, very, very easy, and I do it myself at times, to despair of the challenge of and the magnitude of the problems of extreme poverty that we face. It can also be easy to indulge in self-centered parochialism or to sign a check, get a pat on the back, and move on. But I believe that this strategy doesn't take the easy route, and instead it contributes distinctively to international development, focusing our expertise, being innovative, and employing our unique partnership approach for the global good. So I don't know where the family I mentioned at the start of my speech are today. I don't know if their children managed to get out of the relentless cycle of poverty that passes from generation to generation. And yes, that family is just one of millions of families on the other side of the world. But I firmly believe that they are also fellow members of our global community. They are global citizens, and so are we. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Alison Harris, be followed by Tavish Scott. Ms. Harris, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today, I am proud to stand here as a member of a party whose government at Westminster leads the world in its support for the people of poor nations. Our UK Conservative government has ensured that our country is one of only six in the world who meets the UN target of donating 0.7% of GDP to assist those less fortunate than ourselves. It is good that here in Scotland we add to this contribution by assisting countries with which we have a special bond, such as Malawi. The UK has been setting this example to the rest of the world since 2013, the only member of the G7 to meet the UN target, and of course, by far the largest contributor of any European country. In actual cash terms, over 12.1 billion, second only in the world to the United States, but at 0.71% of GDP, the UK's contribution is far in excess of the 0.17% from the Obama administration. According to a report from the House of Commons Library, and I quote, countries' proximity to achieve the UN target is regarded by the international community as being an indicator of the generosity of individual countries' AIDS policies. Well, that being the case, thanks to both the UK government and our own Scottish international aid, we in Scotland can certainly hold our heads high. High, but we should not and cannot be complacent, as everything possible needs to be done to ensure the aid from the UK taxpayer reaches the designated project and individuals who are in need. Often giving aid to developing countries has had found critics. A lack of targeting, corruption in the receiving countries, or aid being used to allow countries to divert expenditure towards other purposes, often not in keeping with meeting the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. To maintain taxpayers' confidence that their money is well spent, aid must be focused, it must be accountable, and except in emergency humanitarian situations, must always go hand in hand with a recognition by the recipient countries of human rights and freedoms. Michaela Wrong, the author of It's Our Turn to Eat, looked at the corruption in Kenya, but she points to other countries, including Rwanda, where the promotion of democracy and human rights has not had the same focus as building schools. A large number of countries benefit from UK aid. Not surprisingly, nations of the Commonwealth feature highly in the list of recipient countries. Pakistan is a large recipient, with over £350 million of aid from British taxpayers. Other countries in the top 10 include India, Tanzania, Bangladesh, Nigeria, but also Ethiopia, South Sudan, Afghanistan, and Syria. Each receive hundreds of millions of pounds in aid, reflecting recent tragic events. Deputy Presiding Officer, international development aid makes a real difference toward achieving the United Nations global goals. They assist 9 million children in the poorest countries on earth to attend primary school. UK aid has immunised 55 million children against preventable and life-threatening diseases. Further, it is estimated that over 250,000 of newborn children are alive today, thanks to our contribution. Developing sources of clean drinking water, improving agricultural yields, humanitarian aid to people displaced by war and famine, providing shelter, food and medicines. From the refugee camps of Jordan, Turkey and Lebanon to the newly dug wells in the South Sudan, the logo of the UK aid highlighting our flag and the message, aid from the British people is a welcome sight to countless thousands. Not only is this the right thing to do in human terms, but in political terms. Giving aid to the poorest is also the right thing. We must do this. Poverty can provide a recruiting sergeant to those who seek to radicalise, and failed states can become safe havens for enemies of our way of life. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe that it is in our national interest to help alleviate poverty and suffering. As we leave the European Union and take up our historic role in the wider world, we can be proud of what Scotland and the wider UK does. If by our actions it makes it easier for a safer world, then that is no bad thing. Encouraging and giving aid to countries who genuinely aspire to the United Nations global objectives has many positives. But I was also struck by the words of Kirsty McNeill, Executive Director of Policy and Campaigns at Save the Children, who said that we should also play our part because as one of the world's wealthiest and most successful economies, we can. Kirsty put it like this, if I saw a man in the Thames on the way home tonight and I saved him, it may well do wonders for my reputation, but that's not why I do it. I do it because if you can save a life, you should save a life. Deputy Presiding Officer, I applaud the amendment to the motion put forward by my colleague Alexander Stewart, because of course it is good to save a life. But using Kirsty's analogy, what would have happened if she hadn't been passing by? Surely it is better to provide the tools, the know-how, and yes, also the emergency aid when needed. But let us use the aid to empower people in developing countries and to promote the rights of those targeted because of gender or sexuality. That is the difference between these two visions and why I shall be supporting the Conservative amendment. Thank you. Oops, must get it
quicker. Tavish Scott, followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I must confess, when the whip told me I had to speak this afternoon, I had a sense of slight, oh my goodness, not another debate on Brexit. And then I thankfully realised that Alice, that the Minister was not promoting yet another debate on Brexit. Instead, we were debating the international strategy. Although I couldn't resist the tweet I saw this morning on the aforementioned subject, which we'll never hear its name again, which said, fearing her position on Brexit was starting to emerge, Theresa May decided to unclarify it again, which I thought was a fairly accurate summation of the last few days of running commentary that we've seen. But in fairness to my Tory friends, I will say no more on Brexit and no more on tweets either, because the tweet now appears to be the mechanism of foreign policy announcement by the President-elect of the United States, which would cause most of us some concerns. I see his Secretary of State or his nominee for Secretary of State being scrutinised in the Senate today. I think it happens later today, our time, and that will be worth watching. And I hope he gets a few questions on Africa. I suspect Mr. Tillerson's knowledge of Africa will be probably concentrating around Angola and Nigeria, given that ExxonMobil have fairly significant oil interests there. However the Trump administration begins to act internationally, international aid and how it responds to that will be an important component of that. Now, this is a young parliament, and new institutions around the world have to consider the most effective way they can invest limited resources, particularly at times of tougher economic times in the world, how they can contribute, how they can help, and how they can offer assistance. And Alistair Allen and others have been generous today about governments in the past who began a journey that is certainly being continued at this present time and concentrating resources. I suspect this government of today had exactly the same challenge that the one that Lewis and Macdonald and I had shared in previous years as to how we'd win the argument for the budget to be spent in this way, which I don't think should be ignored in the context of the political world we're in. And in fairness to some of my Conservative friends, they've made that observation as well. And secondly, the importance of concentrating the resources that Alistair Allen in this case now may have. The other aspect to this that we can play, Others have talked about much wider avenues of international events, but is to be an active part of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. There are many countries that have been mentioned today which are very much part of that Commonwealth family. Some of the best things I've been involved in as a member of this place is in and with parliamentary colleagues from different legislatures, particularly across Africa. One can meet Canadians and Australians and Kiwis, and we tend to all talk the same talk in terms of audit and parliamentary scrutiny and so on and so forth, and we all do things differently, but there are similarities. But meeting colleagues from Africa is to meet people who've got profoundly different issues, and those colleagues who've been on parliamentary delegations to Malawi in particular are all too well aware of that, and that's why I believe the CPA branch here in Edinburgh, their role in terms of building and helping clerking in parliaments, for example, in Malawi, is some of the kind of practical aspects of democracy that we can bring. Not, as I think Kate Forbes rightly said, not the essence of any kind of colonial reach that this country and other European nations in the past tried to impose, but rather to say, look, here's a way to do it. By all means, go and talk to the Kiwis, go and talk to the Canadians about how they do it as well, but these are some thoughts that you might want to. Others have mentioned the UN today. I must confess, I struggle a bit with the United Nations in the modern world. I read a terrifying account of the reality of Syria and Aleppo right now. It was on a website somewhere this morning. The problem with being critical of the United Nations is, what's the alternative? But none of us can get past the fact that the United Nations Security Council has not covered itself in glory in 6 years of atrocity after atrocity after atrocity in Syria, which I find very difficult to contemplate that any grouping of the world hasn't been able to find some way forward on, but nor it has. A GP I know well works in Uganda, and I just wanted to mention a couple of examples today. A GP I know well works in Uganda. She works for Médecins Sans Frontières. She sent me an email the other day about the 2.2 million people who have fled from South Sudan and the civil war that's going on there into neighbouring countries, some of which have been mentioned here this morning, some of which, of course, are part of the Scottish Government's strategy. And she said, your husband, this is her immediate challenge as a doctor. Your husband was killed in front of you. Your teenage son was forced to stay and fight in South Sudan. You've brought your other three children, plus a couple of orphans you've picked up on the way, into another country, a country you've never been in before. You may have been raped on the way, and it starts to get dark. You go into labour. That is the daily reality. Now, we live sheltered lives, if I may say so, compared to a Scottish GP who happens to be working in an aid camp in Uganda, never mind the woman that she was describing. So if we can do our bit, if we can do a bit more on the medical front, then perhaps we should. And if we can occasionally be a bit more reflective about our own health debates, we probably should as well. When she describes the life-saving interventions for 50,000 people that she's seeking to coordinate in a mobile clinic, which incidentally is, yes, our tent, providing healthcare, vaccination, mental health, care for rape survivors, a network of community health workers, maternity, and an inpatient ward. And yes, that's still another tent. So there is much that we can do in that way as well. Two constituency examples I want to briefly mention today. A brilliant woman who was, again, a nurse in South Africa many years ago, runs Shetland with Love, a charity for children orphaned or abandoned because of HIV, AIDS-related illnesses and violence. And she's quite a woman. She delivered two of Nelson Mandela's grandchildren, met him on several occasions. There's a very fine photograph of that at home in Shetland. But what they do now is to provide help for a charity that is doing simple things like restoring schools, roofs blown off a dining room during a heavy storm, and so on and so forth. Many projects such as that, where the money is all raised locally by people who just want to do their little bit to help in different parts of the world. And the other example, presiding officer, is by an arts teacher, or now a retired arts teacher, Peter Davis, who runs a brilliant project, a non-profit making charitable trust based in Shetland, providing money for Ghana in West Africa. Again, similar educational programs, similar aspects to the Shetland with Love project as well, all about putting money that comes from, yes, our rich part of the world into places where there is none or little or else. That is the place we can play, and the strategy that the Minister has outlined today is an important part of that.
Colin Smith, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government's International Development Strategy document touches on a wide range of matters. I want to focus my brief comments on three main areas. Firstly, the importance of trade and trading relations. Secondly, the key part civil society in Scotland plays in the promotion of international development. And thirdly, the global impact made by NGOs based here in Scotland. In other words, the positive role people living, learning and working right here in Scotland can play internationally. In making these comments, I wish to draw members' attention to my register of interest, where it states I'm a local councillor in Dumfries and Galloway, and that includes a voluntary role as Dumfries and Galloway's fair trade champion. I'm also convener of the Parliament's cross-party group on fair trade, which is an honour so soon after being elected to this chamber. It's a post that gives me the privilege of being able to continue to promote fair trade, and I'd like to take this opportunity to pay tribute to the many volunteers and campaigners who have actively promoted fair trade for many years, particularly in Dumfries and Galloway, where I've worked closely with them as chair of the Regional Fair Trade Steering Group. The contribution volunteers from Dumfries and Galloway have made was most recently recognised at the Scottish Fair Trade Awards, where the Fair Trade Group in the village of Dunsker won the Community Award, Dumfries Fair Trade Group were joint winners of the Campaign of the Year Award, and Dumfries' Paul Tofield won the Volunteer of the Year Award. The region also boasts fair trade groups in Wigton, Kirkcudbright, Castle Douglas, and thanks to the work of all those groups, we are well on the way to achieving fair trade zone status for the whole of Dumfries and Galloway. These are examples of fair trade activities I'm closely aware of, but I know the outstanding activities and campaigns promoting fair trade are to be found in all members' constituencies and regions right across Scotland. Much of this work is organised, coordinated or supported by the Scottish Fair Trade Forum, so I want to commend the valuable role played by the Forum, which not only led the way in securing the fair trade nation status for Scotland mentioned by the Minister in his opening comments, but continues to do so much to ensure we retain that status. It was Scotland, along with Wales, that helped develop the idea of a fair trade nation, and now this model is shaping interest in the development of fair trade nations and regions across the world. In fact, just recently in Glasgow, the Scottish Fair Trade Forum hosted fair trade representatives from Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, the UK's Fair Trade Foundation, Sweden, the Netherlands, Poland, and Canada to discuss the development of the fair trade nations and regions models. In these times when the nature of international connections can sometimes seem fragile, it's welcome to see that Scotland is taking a leadership role in the process of developing a commitment internationally to fair trade. The Fair Trade Nation campaign itself has had the support of all successive governments in Scotland, support I'm pleased to see the International Development Strategy commits to maintaining. Now, much has been achieved in the promotion of fair trade in Scotland, but a lot more still needs to be done. Trade that is fair and mutually beneficial is a means to promote the development that is sustainable and empowering, yet much of global trade is still inherently unfair and exploitative. So the support of government and the people in our communities across Scotland for fair trade needs to continue and has never been more important. However, it's not just in the area of fair trade that the support of government and Civic Scotland is important. There are many examples of positive engagement with international development across civic society. This engagement is perhaps more necessary than ever at a time when uncertainty globally is on the increase. Therefore, the commitment in the strategy to prioritise the engagement of the people of Scotland is important, as is the commitment to raise awareness of Scotland's international development work through networking organisations. I commended earlier the excellent work of the Scottish Fair Trade Forum, which I hope the government will continue to support. But I also want to recognise the work undertaken by other networking and advocacy agencies, such as the Network of International Development Organisations in Scotland, the International Development Education Association Scotland, and the Scotland-Malawi Partnership. It is these networks that build support in Scotland for the work undertaken overseas, and we see that support every day in our communities, not least in our schools. Claudia Beamish has outlined a number of schools in the south of Scotland, and also included is Lockerbie Academy in the south of Scotland, a school that's had a partnership with Tawali Primary School in the Malanje district of Malawi for some 8 years. The link established by the Academy's teacher Helen Wright through Link Community Development Scotland in 2009 has included significant fundraising, enabling the Academy to, amongst many other things, sponsor the Mary's Meal Kitchen in Tawali Primary School. That kitchen has encouraged more pupils than ever before to attend the primary, and thanks to the continuing fundraising efforts of Lockerbie Academy, a scholarship fund has now been set up to allow students from the primary to go on to secondary school. But this global link is about more than just fundraising. It's about sharing experiences through regular exchange visits, and it's about pupils in all years at Lockerbie Academy having the opportunity to be involved in the school's African link, encouraging pupils to be responsible citizens in their local community and to understand they are also citizens of a world community. Now, as well as those learning in Scotland, there are also many examples of people working in the local communities making a massive contribution to international development. I suspect few members will be aware that the world's largest humanitarian mine clearance organisation is actually based here in Scotland in rural Dumfriesshire. The Halo Trust currently works in 20 countries and territories across the world, clearing landmines, cluster munitions and improvised explosive devices. They've destroyed literally tens of millions of bullets and bombs, clearing an area the equivalent of nearly 40,000 football pitches. But their work is about more than just the physical clearance of the debris of war, important indeed life-saving though that work is. In their work to make people and places safe, the Halo Trust very much embed themselves in local communities around the world, providing skills and a livelihood to the 6,500 people they employ, offering opportunities to rebuild lives, preparing the way for development and long-term stability. Although the Trust is not currently active in the four partner countries identified in the government strategies, I do know they are pursuing funding to carry out work in Malawi, where badly stored ammunition in military stores is posing a real threat to the lives of civilians. I hope the Minister will give careful consideration as to whether the Scottish Government could support that work, showing a real commitment to harnessing Scottish expertise as set out in the strategy. Indeed, I would urge the Minister to take the opportunity to visit the Trust headquarters in Canonbridge on the outskirts of Thornhill. I can tell him from my own recent visit that it's a pretty eye-opening experience walking into the HQ and being introduced to the Afghanistan desk officer who was coordinating the work of 2,500 Afghans and international staff from a converted barn in rural Dumfriesshire. It's also very much international development in action taking place right here and right now from Scotland. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I've highlighted just some of the examples of people living, learning and working here in their communities who play such a positive role in promoting and delivering international development. Examples we can be very proud of and which I'm sure are replicated in other members' constituencies. As the government's new strategy is implemented, there's obviously a need for the government to provide more detail in how they're going to turn the good intentions into real action. And I look forward to seeing that detail, including, I hope, continued practical support for fair trade, support for networking organisations to build on public support for international development work, and for NGOs to ensure that we harness Scotland's expertise as a force for good right across the world. Thank you.
I call John Mason to be followed by Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to take part in today's debate. I myself lived and worked for 3 years in Nepal, which at that time in the 1980s was one of the six poorest countries in the world. And I guess for me that immediately raises the question, what about all the other countries that Scotland might have links with? Nepal itself through the Gurkhas and the British Army, Jamaica with the saltire in its flag and our involvement in the slave trade there. And the list could go on and on. But I think in balance it is right to focus on a few countries. We are relatively small ourselves, and we are really only supplementing, I accept, the main UK development budget. And the risk is that we do spread ourselves too thinly and have less effect. But I would hope, as others have said, that we can at least keep some interest in other countries, for example, through the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association and through exchanges with parliaments more widely, which I think is valuable. I also welcome the focus on education and the links between education institutions. That way we can certainly make the money go further as other organisations get involved in sharing the costs. An example of that has been schools in my own constituency, and as other members have mentioned their schools, I would mention Bannerman High, for example, who not only have been able to raise funds to take youngsters from Scotland out to Malawi, but have also raised funds to bring youngsters from Malawi to visit here in Scotland. Now, there will, of course, be those who argue against Scotland having any international development programme at all. And I meet people like that in my constituency and, of course, in Twitterland, where I enjoy spending some of my time. And we have so many needs here, people say. Shouldn't we just focus on them? But I would say a couple of things to that. First of all, it is not the poorest people in my constituency who say that kind of thing. I see pensioners and others who are not well off running coffee mornings or other fundraising events and giving their own money sacrificially in order to help people in other countries who they know are less well off than themselves. And secondly, we live in an interdependent world and we really cannot separate what is good for Scotland from what is good in Malawi, Pakistan, Zambia or Rwanda. To put it in crude economic terms, if we want to sell our goods, like whiskey, to other countries around the world, then clearly it is to our advantage if they have stronger economies and many more of their residents can afford to buy our goods. That is why I'm so keen on supporting fair trade, which we've just heard so eloquently from Colin Smith on, which not only is morally right that people earn a decent wage for their work, but it benefits their economy and ours as well, if all of that works. Another argument sometimes used against Scotland engaging in international development can be that there already is wealth in some of these countries. Pakistan is an obvious example of that, with some very wealthy individuals, and a country which can spend a lot of money on sophisticated military weapons. Yet there is obviously still extreme poverty in that country, and we have a responsibility to help those in greatest need. And that is why I particularly welcome the strategy being to work in conjunction with governments while not actually giving the cash to the governments. On that point of working with, can I also make another point? And of course, we want to help these four countries as much as we can, but there are aspects of life in all of these countries which are better than ours, and we can learn and we should learn from them as well. I have visited three of the four, and one example of the strengths I have seen would be strong family bonds and care for the elderly. But that I do not mean better material care for the elderly, but I have seen a real sense of duty towards the older generation, which I think we used to have here in Scotland, but which we can be in danger of losing as we expect wider society to shoulder most of the responsibility for our elderly relatives. Now, that is not to say that we should not also hope to share some of our values with these other countries. But I hope we can do it, as one or two others have said today, from that position of mutual respect and not talking down to them, as has often been done by Western countries, including ourselves, in the past. Briefings for today's debate included the encouragement to remember the most marginalised in these societies, and I certainly agree with that. It's not entirely easy, as we have a limited budget and limited influence, and we need to get the balance right between respecting different values and traditions on the one hand, while calling a spade if something is wrong. Mary Slessor is still respected in Nigeria, despite her challenging the tradition that twins were bad. Obviously, she went about it in the right way, and in the long run has been respected for her challenge. One area of concern I hope we can work on is treatment of those of a minority religion, or even no religion. People should be free to worship in the faith of their choice, they should be free to change religion or faith, and they should be able to abandon all faith if they choose to do so. Yet in Pakistan, Christians can be treated very much as second-class citizens, while there is little protection in the legal system, and often they are open to empty charges of blasphemy. And even Pakistani Muslim leaders who challenge this system can put themselves at great risk. Hopefully, through sharing in education and other ways, we can discuss this kind of issue with our partners while still respecting their culture. In relation to Pakistan, can I also say I was extremely disappointed when the UK Government Borders Agency refused visas recently for Pakistani church leaders visiting Scotland under the auspices of Glasgow Presbytery of the Church of Scotland. I'm very glad that situation has been reversed, and I think that is partly due to the intervention of the Minister and his colleagues. But going forward, I hope there would be some kind of agreement with the UK Government that Scotland has a relationship with these four countries, and at the very least, they will not put obstacles in the way of visitors coming here from there. Again, this shows the importance of the third sector in general and churches and religious organisations in particular in taking forward our relationships around the world. Finally, we often come up against this question of sustainable development versus short-term emergency aid. Should it be one or the other? The strategy clearly says it should be both. So as well as the International Development Fund, there is also the Humanitarian Aid Fund. Of course, we should be aiming for each country to be as self-reliant as it can be. But if children today cannot go to school because there is no food, then we have to tackle that problem too, and I welcome the likes of Mary Meals, who do so much in this regard. There is a lot more that could be said, but the key thing is that it is great that Scotland has an international development strategy, and although we might debate some of the details, there is broad agreement that this is the direction we should be going in. Thank you.
Maurice Corey, please, to be followed by Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to pay tribute to the comments made about Mary's Meals and their team on their fantastic work they do around the world, which the Minister very kindly referred to. And particularly as a resident of Argyll and Bute in my own county, I'm particularly proud of the work they do based from Loch Gilphead. As one of the world's leading economic powers, one of the world's key long-term stable democratic states, and one of the world's most compassionate nations, it is only right that the UK and Scotland play a key role in helping other nations through our aid projects and our aid spending. And I'd like to commend Tavish Scott's comments in his speech about the work and the examples he gave of the situations abroad, wonderful work that's done, the harrowing situations people find themselves in, and particularly the work delivered to sort those situations out by several British people. I've seen it, I've experienced it in the world, parts of the world I've worked in. The UK as a whole should be congratulated for contributing the second largest amount of aid to other countries on the planet, only behind the United States of America. The UK as a whole provides over £12 billion in aid mainly to Africa and Asia. The UK is also currently the only G7 nation that meets its obligations set by the United Nations to provide 0.7% of its GDP on international aid spending. That's thanks to a Conservative government which has legislated to protect the UK's international aid project and budget. That's because of the international aid spending doesn't just help those receiving it, which of course would be enough reason to spend it, but it also does to help us here at home. It means countries can have the opportunity to develop economically, creating jobs and growth locally, meaning hopefully more customers to our products and services overseas and us receiving more business from this area. It also means countries are less likely to produce the conditions necessary for terror organisation and, more importantly, the hateful radicalisation they spout to thrive, which means we are safer here on our streets at home. Additionally, it gives other countries the breathing space they need to develop political institutes and institutions and creating flourishing new democracies across the world where before they haven't existed. I was actually lucky enough to meet some members and officials from the Pakistani Provincial Assembly of the Khyber Pashtunkhwa delegation, which visited the parliament this last November. They were across learning about the procedures and the practices of our parliament in the hope of implementing best practice in their assembly back home. The visit by the delegation is a perfect example of the sort of expertise and example of what we can provide to others alongside our financial help. My other personal experience of offering aid and support was while serving in Bosnia and in support in Afghanistan. We were providing logistical support to vehicles and for vehicles and their movements to help move aid around the country and also to train up the Afghan National Police to ensure effective security in Afghanistan and its efforts in securing its borders. From my own experience, these are part of the so-called golden rules when stabilizing developing countries. 1, establish a secure and stable environment. 2, ensure supplies of water and electricity. Get the lights switched on. It's amazing the positive effect this has when those lights go on. And I can tell you, I saw it happening in Sarajevo in Bosnia, and they were switched on by a Glasgow engineer. Making sure that the transport systems are operational and effective. Opening the shops so commerce and normal day-to-day life begins to operate, and providing medical services and education. Providing these basic services and building the infrastructure is something we are brilliant at in this country, and we are second to none, and I'm pleased to see that these areas are covered by aid spending in one way or another. And the many of the Scots who go there to help deliver these come from our own country here, and a lot of them are in very high positions in those aid projects and have been at it many years, and their skills, in engineering particularly, are absolutely brilliant. The last point is of the utmost importance, and that's providing education, which I'm pleased to see this strategy has focused, certainly in part. In Pakistan, for example, the fact that over 7 million children are not in school is a disaster waiting to happen. The lack of even basic education for so many is going to create problems down that line in that country. That's why we must encourage them into school and also into further and higher education, in particular young women. As has been noted by the World Bank chief economist, an investment in women's education could potentially provide the highest return available. It is not just economically beneficial, but is also socially beneficial in many parts of the world. And I believe that for those parts of Pakistan where the education of women is not the norm, for example, in rural areas, which also happen to be some of the poorest parts of that country, the benefits will be felt most of all there. It is why the announcement of the £300,000 of the Scottish Government to create a scholarship programme back in 2013, enabling women from disadvantaged backgrounds to study their master courses in education and environment, was a very, very welcome step. We can only imagine how much these parts of Pakistan will improve, having two or three generations of women educated and their education being considered the norm and not an exception. Alongside the other projects that Scotland is supporting in Pakistan, including those that will support the agricultural sector in the country, not only helping to secure food supply in Pakistan, but also so that the large number of smallholder farmers in Pakistan can benefit more from their work and can begin to build up the wealth amongst their group, rather than the hand-to-mouth and day-by-day existence many currently have. Scotland is doing great work in that country, alongside great organisations like Mercycorps, Oxfam, Tier Fund, Christian Aid and others, and with its large energy and mineral reserves and position near some of the world's busiest shipping lanes, the opportunities for Pakistan are massive. It is certainly the opportunity to turn itself into the first world democratic state, and hopefully, with our help, they will be able to do just that. And that is why, therefore, today, Deputy Speaker, I will be supporting the Conservative amendment in this debate. Thank you.
I call Bruce Crawford to be followed by Elaine Smith.
President Officer, I was really delighted to learn that the Scottish Government had decided to bring forward this particular debate so early in the new year. I was delighted because actually 2016 was such a miserable year for those of us who believe in progressive politics, as it seemed that reactionary forces and intolerance increased and isolation increases were on the march across the globe. And I thought this debate gives us the chance to remind ourselves and the world that Scotland is the home of citizens where by far the majority are outward looking and want to give a helping hand to those who are less fortunate in the world. And this debate gives us a chance to provide a positive and forward looking perspective on what we in this Parliament can do to help others in the world by shining a bright light on what can be achieved in this field and help to banish some of these blues of 2016. Now, yes, there will always be those who have a negative view towards the Scottish Government contributing to international aid, as John Mason alluded to, just like a constituent who contacted me only in the last few days. But I would contend, as I did with him, that Scotland has a unique contribution to make to the world. And let me give you an example from the Friends of the Earth briefing paper, which explained that the Climate Justice Fund was established in 2013 with a budget of only around £1 million to help tackle the effects of climate change in four sub-Saharan African countries, Malawi, Zimbabwe, Tanzania and Rwanda. And this was increased to £3 million in 2015. Achievements of that fund so far include providing more than 75,000 people with access to clean, safe drinking water and training to 110,000 people in climate change and water rights. In addition, Scotland's in a position to help mitigate and help adapt to climate change in these areas by sharing knowledge and expertise, especially in the areas of water management and energy. Now, I make these particular point on climate change because this is a vital area for work if we're going to avoid mass displacement of human beings, enabling people to live in their own homelands in safety, removed from absolute poverty. And as I think, I can't remember who reflected on it, but someone mentioned Skia, I think it was Joan McAlpin actually, saying that can't simply, when we're doing these tasks, it can't simply be all about exploiting the skills of our own people, but making sure that we're developing local skills in that activity. And then working in this way, not only can we help troubled parts of the world, but I believe hugely enrich ourselves. I know that when I go about my own daily job as an MSP, if I'm helping someone get a bit of justice against a government agency or and helping them in their general lives, I feel good about myself. There's absolutely no reason why our nation shouldn't feel it the same when it's doing good things and around the world. But with that constituent and others that John Mason, and I'm sure others have had these same experiences in their own parts of the world, we've still got a big job to do in raising awareness in our own country to let others see the virtue of such works. And as Maurice Corey said, that's as much about letting them understand that if we're acting positively in these other parts of the world, it's as much for our own good as it is for them. And I really believe we need to do something about that. That helps us break down intolerance and isolationism in the same way. Now, I know the Scottish Government is committed to integrating the principles and priorities of its international development programme into its broader policy agenda. And this clearly doesn't just mean throwing money into a country and hoping for the best. Instead, the international development policy seeks to harness the existing links Scotland has and use our people's expertise in areas such as climate change, as we've already talked about, education, health improvement, and to create a model of civil society-led partnerships. And in Scotland and the Scottish Government have found innovative ways to tap into incredible expertise, goodwill and willingness to volunteer time across Scotland and in partner countries. This more holistic, as they say, beyond aid approach means having all groups, government, local government, public bodies, the private sector, communities and individuals adapt their behaviour in support of global goals. And aid is only a small part of international development work. Some of the greater benefits to the world's poorest and most vulnerable can be brought about through policy changes by developed countries. The Beyond Aid policy recognises the variety of development challenges that the underdeveloped countries face. And by addressing the causes of seemingly intractable challenges, you can help reduce their impact on future generations. And aid alone, I think, as we all know, will not end poverty. I also believe that by focusing, as others have said, our efforts on a selector number of countries, we're able to maximise our impact. And we've heard about the refreshed international development strategy targets support for communities in four countries. And everyone's reflected, or most people have reflected, on the impact we've had in Malawi over the last 150 years, with currently more than 94,000 Scots being actively involved in civic links with Malawi, making it probably the world's strongest north to south civic links, and it's central to the Scottish government's work. And in my own constituency, there are a number of organisations involved in this type of activity. Bannockburn High School, Kincardine Menteith Primary School and St Ninian's Primary School, of all links with Malawi, which are informing and inspiring generations of young Scots to be good global citizens. There are other links with Malawi which are helping to transform the lives in both Malawi and in Scotland. And I know that in 2015, Bannockburn High School sent a group of students and teachers to Malawi for the first time, and they helped build and refurbish classrooms. I can only imagine just how much they learned about their own lives and the lives of others, especially through the relationships they formed. Presiding Officer, in closing, I want Scotland to be able to empower our partner countries and in turn to go on to effect change and work towards sustainable development in their own countries for their own communities. And we've heard today across the chamber, international aid is much more than just about giving money. It's about establishing links, learning from each other, and playing our part in tackling global challenges. I want Scotland to be proud of the role we play across the world in doing just that. Thank you.
And the last of the open speeches is Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by declaring something of an interest as a member of the CPA Scotland Branch Executive, and also take this opportunity to thank our Parliament International Relations Office staff and team for all the work that they do on Parliament's behalf, advancing both inward and outward international relations and supporting the CPA. I'm also co-vice-convener of the Malawi Cross-Party Group, and as a Deputy Presiding Officer in the last session, I led a delegation in 2015 to Malawi to recognise the 10-year anniversary of the Scotland-Malawi relationship at parliamentary level, and I would like to recommend the report of that visit to members if they haven't already read it. It would be difficult, Presiding Officer, to disagree with the Government's motion, and in particular the recognition of the strong cross-party collaboration and support for international development, and I'm pleased that the Government have indicated that they are accepting Labour's amendment. It's important to recognise the legitimate role that this Parliament and the Scottish Government have in the field of international development, and I say that because there has been criticism from some quarters about the Government and indeed Parliament spending money on international development, and I note that that is a point that was made earlier by Joan McAlpine. But Scotland's got a massive contribution to make to international development and to tackling poverty and inequality across the globe, using our expertise and innovation through partnership working, and we have a long, proud history of doing that. Presiding Officer, Oxfam provided an interesting briefing for this debate, and in that they stated, good quality aid saves lives and can unlock people's ability to work their own way out of poverty. I also want to put on the record that they state that conditionality should be avoided, and I agree with that point that they make. Oxfam also point out that a human rights approach to our international development work is vital and must go beyond material resources, considering and addressing the capacity, choices and power needed for people living in poverty to enjoy their human rights. And I note that other members have mentioned that throughout the debate. Oxfam also proposed that a do-no-harm approach should go further and that government should have a more proactive do-good policy, as well as implementing policy coherence for development, and should produce a publicly accessible annual expenditure report to aid openness and accountability. And I'd be interested in the Minister's response to that in the summation to the debate. In the time I have left, Presiding Officer, though, I want to turn to focusing on Malawi, which I recognise other members have also done. I recently noted that Malawi was a pointless answer on one of my favourite BBC programmes when people were naming African countries, and I actually doubt if that would have been the case if the question had been asked only in Scotland. Indeed, the Scotland-Malawi Partnership found that not only is there a high awareness among Scots of the people-to-people links with Malawi at 49%, there's also a remarkably high level of active and diverse civic involvement. 46% of Scots know someone involved in one of 40 different types of links with Malawi. And there is also remarkably strong public support for these civic links with Malawi, with 74% in favour and only 3% against. And when viewed alongside comparable international development surveys across the UK, it's quite clear then that Scotland's people-to-people partnership with Malawi is quite exceptional in terms of public awareness, engagement and perception. And I think a lot of that is down to the work that has been done via the government and via the parliament, as well as the work that's done in civic society. Of course, our links have Christian roots going back over 150 years to David Livingstone from Lanarkshire and other Scottish missionaries who are still remembered fondly in Malawi. And our most recent extremely close parliamentary relationship goes back to 2005 with the then First Minister, Jack McConnell, establishing our unique cooperation agreement with Malawi, a point mentioned by various other members, including Stuart Stevenson. The Scotland-Malawi Partnership is keen that contributions in today's debate, or was keen, since we're reaching the end of the debate, that contributions emphasise the vital role that civic society plays in driving Scotland's international development work, and members have done that throughout the debate. Many churches and voluntary organisations have connections with Malawi. We've heard of several of those, or lots of those actually, during the debate, but I want to specifically mention the Healthy Lifestyle Project Aiming Higher in Malawi, supported by North Lanarkshire Council and run by Charles Fawcett. That project has been running for nearly two decades, and at one level it involves local schools in Coatbridge and Airdrie having partnerships with schools in the Malanje area, and young people learn through education here about Malawi, but they also fundraise, and many have the opportunity to go out to Malawi and do voluntary work. And when I was there, I was lucky to see some of the Healthy Lifestyle projects, in particular the Girls Go for Health team in Manjulo Parish, which was empowering women to set up enterprise activities and supporting girls in school through things like confidence building, but also practical support. So, for example, providing sanitary wear. And I also visited children being assisted by the Disabled Children Programme, providing wheelchairs, crutches, other aids and transports. These projects need government assistance to support the fantastic work that they're doing on the ground. The International Development Strategy can and should provide help to such projects where the funds are going directly into communities and the people are being given the skills and tools to help themselves in the longer term. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, being a good global citizen is vitally important in a world where so many people live in abject poverty, and of course the main purpose of aid is to tackle such poverty, and that remains vitally important. But being a good global citizen also involves promoting and supporting human rights, fairness, equality, sustainable development, fair trade and climate justice. And Scotland's international development strategy must do all of that. Like others, I welcome the government's newly refreshed strategy today. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call Anna Sarwar. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Sarwar.
Deputy Presiding Officer, can I start by saying it's been a fantastic debate that we've had in the Chamber today, and I think it reflects the best of this Parliament, how we have unified around the important goals of not just delivering for people right here in Scotland, but actually looking out for those less fortunate right around the world. Now, critics of development often say that charity begins at home, and I agree with them. Charity does begin at home, but as is demonstrated today, it doesn't end there. We have a responsibility to the world, both in social terms, economic terms, but also in terms of our human interest as well, to look out for all our common citizens in this global village. A point very well made by Stuart Stevenson, by Katie Forbes, and by Alison Harris. As Alistair Allen and Elaine Smith have both said, Scotland has a historic link with development. We have been beacons to the world about reaching out and looking out for those less fortunate. And I think that's why I'm so proud that it was a Labour government that delivered not just the initial £3 million of development spend coming from this place, but actually also delivered the Department for International Development. And Lewis MacDonald has also made clear the point that Labour has played a huge role in trying to get this great consensus on development right across the United Kingdom. Because we have come... I'm happy to take an intervention.
Stuart Stevenson.
Just for completeness, it might be as well to recognise the contribution that the person in the chair today made to the debate in 2006, where she supported the aims as well. So it's always an opportunity to sook up to the presiding officer too.
You're such a sook, Mr. Stevenson. Mr. Sarwar, you could do with being a sook
yesterday. I was sooking up to the presiding officer, so today I'll sook up to the deputy presiding officer, so I will echo that point again, a very well made. But I think it's important to see how far we've come in the last 20 years, because 20 years ago in our politics, we were debating whether or not we should even have a Department for International Development in the United Kingdom. We've moved past that. The debates then became about whether we should have a 0.7% commitment in terms of international aid. Again, we found consensus on that issue. So I welcome the fact that what we're now debating is not if we spend money, but actually how we spend money to help those people that are struggling right around the world. But I will take an intervention, but I'm running out of time quickly.
Helen Smith.
Apologies, it was just in recognising people's contribution. I wondered if you would recognise the contribution of Tom Clark in the reporting of the 0.7%.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
I was just actually coming to that to say it was a particularly proud moment for myself to lead from the front bench in the UK Parliament when we did deliver the 0.7% bill, an issue that Tom Clark led and inspired on in terms of that Parliament. And actually it was Mike Crockhart, so to pay tribute to the Liberal Democrats as well, who made that bill happen in terms of a private member's bill that passed right across the UK. But I wanted to pick up on a point that Joan McAlpine quite rightly made, is that we can't be complacent. Yes, we have found consensus, but we can't be complacent about the risks to that consensus. And I would therefore gently say to Mr. Thompson, who highlighted concerns about where aid spend might go and the negative consequence of it, it's actually his government in the UK that has developed the International Development Tracker, where you can actually track where the money goes in terms of the UK's aid spend to make sure it's not going to negative places. So I perhaps ask Mr. Thompson to maybe go and look at the development tracker and see where the UK money is going. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Mr. Thompson.
I do welcome that. I'm sure you'll appreciate I was referring to a particular case of the chairman of World Vision, and that we do always need to learn lessons when any incident like this occurs, that we always must be diligent to prevent the abuse of international aid.
Anna Sarwar.
We should always learn lessons, but in actual fact, I think Mr. Thompson was suggesting that aid that was being sent from this country to the Gaza Strip was perhaps being used for illegitimate purposes. I think if you actually look at the development tracker, you can see where every penny of international development aid from the UK has been going to in Gaza to feed, clothe people who otherwise would be starving and indeed dying in the Gaza Strip. But an important point also to be made is it's not about just aid, it's actually about development. It's important, of course, we clothe people, we feed people, that we support them in a humanitarian crisis, but it's called international development for a reason. And that is because we want to support developing countries to hopefully make them developed countries. And we do that by helping to support institutions, by helping to promote good governance, by helping to promote universal education programmes and universal health programmes, a point made very well by Tavis Scott. But we should also recognise our other commitments and obligations as well. Claudia Beamish rightly mentioned climate change. The impacts of climate change, the actions that we take here in the UK, has an impact in terms of land mass, it has an impact in terms of water taking over land, and indeed mass migration of individuals, which again can drive people into extreme poverty. So our responsibilities on climate change, we shouldn't forget either. I wanted to pick up on Alexander Stewart's amendment, which rightly mentions the role of the UK in terms of DFID, the second largest aid agency in the world, based here in Scotland in East Kilbride, employing thousands of people, having a budget of £12.1 billion. So Scotland, yes, contributes to £10 million through this government, but actually contributes over £1 billion to the Department for International Development. And through that Department for International Development, we demonstrate how we can pool and share resource to actually maximise income and also maximise impact for those suffering in the most vulnerable places. For example, in Malawi, 86 million, Zambia, 57 million, Rwanda, 101 million, and in the case of Pakistan, the single largest recipient of UK aid, £374 million a year. I want to just say in closing a couple of things. One is that, yes, we have a responsibility in terms of development, but let's not forget that the importance of institutions. Failures to pay tax are three times as much as the complete global aid budget combined. So failing to introduce tax systems in these countries is absolutely crucial. How we procure is also very important. That's why I think the points made by Colin Smith around fair trade are also important. And one of the things that we should do is also take into account our diaspora communities who we can share from and learn lessons from. And that's why I think we should try and shape some kind of participatory development so we can use the expertise of our diaspora community to target our aid, but also to win confidence that our aid is actually delivering and making a result. I just want to close by saying that we take the issues of health and education and the rights of women and girls really, really seriously here in Scotland. But actually that right and that privilege shouldn't just be for Scots and indeed for British people. It should be a principle for people, men, women and children right around the world. Yes, we have poverty here, but there's extreme poverty right around the world. And I hope, working in this parliament and indeed across the world, we can eliminate poverty globally.
I call Rachel Hamilton. No more than 8 minutes, please, Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We are all proud of our involvement in international development today. Many have made reference to Scotland's commitment to the social, economic and environmental global goals. Both Stuart Stevenson and Claudia Beamish rightly paid tribute to Ban Ki-moon and his role in the UN. Cross-party, we agree that the Parliament can set an example to our young people, an example that shares values of humanity, tolerance, compassion and progressiveness. We are, after all, as the motion states, part of an interlinked global community. Demonstrating global citizenship cuts through the detail in our own lives and encourages us to look closer at others' lives. As Alexander Stewart said, we are proud to be able to provide aid to people who are less well off than ourselves. Scottish universities play an important role, often linking courses to development work in respective countries. Of course, not only can universities share their knowledge, in this regard, as members have highlighted today, Scotland as a whole can share its knowledge and collaborate on projects where we face common challenges such as health, education and renewable energy. Alistair Allen talked about the Blantyre to Blantyre research project linking health in Glasgow and Malawi and Mary's Meals feeding over 1 million children in Malawi, also mentioned by Maurice Corrie and John Mason. Joe McAlpine gave us a poignant Chinese proverb to demonstrate ways for people in Malawi to feed themselves in a sustainable way through an aquaculture project developed between Malawi and Stirling University. Mention has been made of Scotland's distinctly different approach, and Lewis MacDonald rightly talked about civic activity, stating that for every £1 committed by the Scottish Government, around £8 come from civic society. There are many ways to engage, and Kate Forbes was recently a mentor at the Youth Parliament and was heartened by the quality of leadership shown, giving hope for great global partnerships in the future. And Colin Smith gave examples of the importance of fair trade activities throughout Scotland. Claudia Beamish passionately spoke of global violence against women and children. One of the harmful cultural practices is female genital mutilation. The UN reports that the practice is carried out in 29 countries, the procedure performed on over 125 million girls and women. Through targeted focus on this issue from both Scotland and the UK government, I hope we will see this practice abolished. I'd like to bring the attention to the Chamber of the recent contribution made by Priti Patel, announcing an extra £6 million to fight abuse against abuse to women and girls. This on top of the $12.1 billion the UK government has already given in funding to developing countries. The £6 million package announced in November will go towards supporting innovative grassroots programmes in 17 countries dealing with female genital mutilation, child marriage and domestic violence. The funding has been welcomed by many in the aid sector because it will impact significantly on smaller projects thought to make such a difference to women's lives. It is true that our country will not tolerate any form of violence against women and girls, so it's shocking to learn from the UN that 35% of women worldwide have experienced either physical or sexual abuse at some points in their lives. As a reaction to these unacceptable statistics, extra funding has been dedicated to break the cycle of abuse. 2.75 million of the funding will go to the UN Trust Fund to end violence against women, to tackle gender-based violence, improve access to legal assistance and healthcare, and work towards strengthening laws that protect women. I am pleased that the Minister supports the Scottish Conservative amendment that calls on the Scottish Government to promote the needs of vulnerable groups. I am a little disappointed, however, that the Scottish Government will not support our amendment that highlights the importance of economic growth, a factor that will see our partner countries prosper through sustainable growth. Hopefully the Minister will reflect on the backbenchers such as John Mason, who talked about the importance of trade and self-reliance. I certainly will.
Stuart Stevenson.
In the 2006 debate on the subject, your colleague Murdo Fraser ended his contribution by saying, "We'll make a difference to people's lives in Malawi and encourage the Scottish Executive to carry on its work," creating consensus across the Parliament. Notwithstanding some difficulties with the Tory amendment today, will the Tories be supporting the unamended motion should that be what the final vote is tonight?
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Stuart Stevenson for that intervention, and the answer is yes. Ross Thompson made it clear that within our partner countries, we should promote human rights defending minority groups and the most vulnerable. The Scottish Conservatives support the Labour amendment to further promote the needs of minority, marginalised and vulnerable groups in these countries, where such groups are often subject to criminalisation and harassment. Deputy Presiding Officer, both the Scottish and UK government have a strong record of helping countries less fortunate than our own, from ending female genital mutilation and child marriage to preventing domestic abuse. Aid helps survivors in some of the world's poorest countries. I hope both governments will continue to increase our global leadership and support to protect even more women and girls and address the root causes of violence and promote the needs of those marginalized groups in need of support. My colleagues across the chamber have almost unanimously agreed that Scotland's continued engagement in international development, without doubt, has huge impact across our partner countries, and we must continue to show and promote collaborative cross-party efforts. Thank you.
I now call on Alistair Allen to wind up this debate. Around 9 minutes, please, Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by saying how pleased I was to see earlier on in the gallery the Malawian High Commissioner, Kenam Fonda, and it was further testimony to the warm relationship that exists between our countries, which many members have spoken of today. But I'd like to thank all members who've contributed to today's debate and to all countries that they've referred to. There is, as has been mentioned, cross-party support, as represented by the comments of Mr. Stewart, Mr. MacDonald, many others. And I'm happy to begin by taking up the invitation to meet the cross-party group on Malawi, which Mr. MacDonald referred to, and over the coming months to providing further information on an ongoing basis about the work that we're doing and the plans that we have on a country-by-country basis. John McAlpine made an important point in the debate, which is that helping the world's poorest is a good thing, and that anyone who tells us otherwise deceives us and themselves. It is important to deal head-on with the myths that are sometimes published about the question of international development. And it is important for us to say, too, that Despite what you may have heard elsewhere, the Scottish Government does not give money to governments on this matter. The point made by Ross Thompson is an important one. We should not keep silent about human rights. It should be at the heart of all that we do in our international development work. On my recent visit to Malawi, I raised the issues of LGBTI rights and also met representatives of people of the community, of people who have albinism, who are subject in some parts of the country to persecution from some quarters. Mr. Yousaf, my predecessor, previously met a delegation of Christian leaders in Pakistan in 2013 to hear their concerns. So to respond to points that were made by many speakers, the question of human rights is at the forefront of all we do. And to respond specifically to one issue that Claudia Beamish raised in this respect, yes, I can confirm that the Scottish Government actively works to tackle violence against women and children, and we work to highlight the issue specifically of child marriage in Malawi. And in Pakistan, over £600,000 has been spent to date on the question of, or on the subject area of empowering women through education. And also, regarding a point made by Claudia Beamish about conflict resolution, I'm happy to confirm that the Scottish Government has been supporting 50 women every year from conflict zones around the world to allow them to play their full role in the peace process in their countries. I will, yes, briefly.
Elaine Smith.
Thanks for taking the intervention. I wonder if the Minister has had any opportunity to look at the issue of juvenile justice in Malawi, particularly juvenile prisons.
Alistair Allen.
Yes, when I was in Malawi, I actually visited Chance for Change, which is a project which is run specifically with the issues that the member raises in mind to divert young people from aspects of the justice system to allow them to be rehabilitated in the community. And Scotland has made a great contribution towards the good work that has been done in many individuals' lives in that respect. There were many, many points made about numerous countries, as I say, by speakers. But if I can pick up on one or two questions that were raised about NGOs and their funding, and specifically the question of three-year funding, I should say that current grants under development programmes are generally 3 years, and that we have said in the strategy we will consider how we might support longer-term partnerships for all three-year funded streams. But as Mr. Sarwar points out, the question now is not just about whether we spend money, but how the money is spent and what projects are supported. John Mason raised the question of what we do beyond the four partner countries that we operate in. And he and others, of course, have acknowledged that our programme is limited. However, of course, there is a huge contribution made by the Scottish public and by the Scottish civic society around the world. And one way we can emphasise that contribution is through the help that we give to the fair trade movement, which is one of the ways that we show that commitment on a much wider number of countries. Colin Smith rightly highlighted the good work of the Halo Trust in Dumfriesshire and his constituency. I'm aware of the vital work that they do, and indeed Ms Hislop was delighted to meet a delegation from them on the 25th of October. Bruce Crawford focused on the manner in which Scotland goes about international development and the importance of addressing the causes of poverty as well as treating its symptoms. I acknowledge two points made by Mr. Scott and others about the role of previous administrations and previous parties in government in the establishment of much of the work that we continue with and which we expand. Perhaps picking out one or two examples that I didn't have time to mention earlier on of our work, it's worth mentioning the hydronation area of activity. And while in Scotland we're fortunate to have an abundance or a superabundance of water, it's important to remember that that's not a privilege enjoyed by all around the world. And sustainable development goal number 6 is specifically about water and sanitation. And both our climate justice and hydronation initiatives have already delivered success in this area in many parts of the world. As Claudia Beamish again mentioned, Scotland's international approach to climate change is at the centre of what we do and what we should do. And one key point about climate change, a point made to me when I was in Malawi by some of the world's poorest people, I should say, was that climate change is not created by them, but affects them disproportionately. I want to mention before we conclude one or two other areas around humanitarian aid. In the course of the debate, members referred to humanitarian disasters that have been. So I should take this opportunity to emphasise that this government is strengthening its capacity to respond quickly and effectively to urgent humanitarian crises overseas. So we will establish a separate £1 million humanitarian aid fund to respond to those urgent crises. I want to conclude again by referring briefly, if I may, to my recent visit to Malawi. And I want to also end by referring to an important and at times very moving contribution made by Kate Forbes, who reminded us that international development, if it is to be about anything at all, is about individual real people. People with the same inalienable rights to dignity that we never question that we as individuals have ourselves. And when I had the privilege of being in Malawi, it was truly amazing to see the number and variety of projects which Scotland supports in that country and in other countries too. Nothing prepares visitors for the warmth and kindness of Malawian people, and neither does anything prepare the visitor for the reality and immensity of many people's needs. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, this month, as we mark the first anniversary of the new UN Global Goals coming to force, there is no doubt that this is a timely debate and one which allows us to demonstrate that Scotland continues to play its part as a good global citizen, meeting both our own domestic and international challenges head on. So, Presiding Officer, we will continue to lead by example through our commitment to the UN Global Goals, helping to tackle poverty-related issues, and we will do this in our best traditions of humanitarianism and global solidarity, mobilising our skills and our expertise in the fight against poverty and injustice, both here in Scotland and beyond.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on welcoming global citizenship. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of business motion 3322 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 3322.
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I'll put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 3322 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 3323 on the designation of a lead committee.
Moved.
Thank you very much. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, which we will come to in about 15 seconds. Thank you. And there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 3303.1 in the name of Alexander Stewart, which seeks to amend Motion 3303 in the name of Alistair Allen on welcoming global citizenship, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 3303.1 in the name of Alexander Stewart is yes 29, No, 94. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 3303.2 in the name of Lewis MacDonald, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Alistair Allen, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that motion 3303 in the name of Alistair Allen, as amended, on global citizenship, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And the final question is that motion 3323 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the designation of a lead committee be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And that concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business in the name of Liz Smith. Just take a few moments to change seats.